Well, good evening, and welcome to the worship of God. Preparation for worship this evening comes to us from Carl Henry. Carl Henry was a longtime editor of Christianity Today, one of the first ones, rather famous theologian in his time. We're going to hear from him in the sermon as well, but this is what he had to say in his memoir about his conversion. Into the darkness of my young life, God put bright stars that still shine, and they sparkle. Maybe you saw, I think we thought it was Venus right by the moon on the way here tonight. And that's what he's talking about. This bright stars in his life, only sense of joy, kindness, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. All these bright stars in his sky of his life that still sparkle and shine. And after that encounter, I walked the world with God as my friend. This evening we'll be thinking about neighbors and friends from Proverbs, because Proverbs talks an awful lot about neighbors, awful lot about friends, and we're going to be thinking about that. Our call to worship is, where do we put our trust? It starts off with where we shouldn't put our trust. A horse is a vain hope for deliverance. Despite all its great strength, that can't save. You could put anything in there that you wanted to say is a vain hope for deliverance. Politicians are a vain hope for deliverance. For all their great strength, they can't save. Money is a vain hope for deliverance. For all its great strength, they can't save. Whatever good thing that you hope can help you, God is saying, okay, you need to trust me, the 11th and 12th graders. We studied that today in catechism. But the eyes of the Lord are on those who fear him, on those whose hope is in his unfailing love. And that's what we're here to do. We're here to tell God our hope is in him. And that we tremble before him because we know he can do way more than we understand, but yet he chooses to do good to us. Let's go to him in prayer, asking that would be where our hearts are at this evening. Father, I do pray for all of us that our hearts would have this trembling trust, this fear and awe and reverence and delight all mixed together, and that we would have said, it's, Father, good to have worshiped the living God, being reminded where our help comes from. Pray that for me. I pray that for all of us. We ask this in your Son's name. Amen. Going to be standing and worshiping God together, singing four verses of He Leadeth Me. you through your life, greets you with these words, and may grace be yours. May God's mercy be yours. May his peace rest upon you. And these come from the Father, from Jesus the Christ, and from the Holy Spirit. And all of God's people said, amen. And as God's welcomed us, let's welcome one another. Good evening. Going to be saying together what it is that Christians have said together in a whole host of different languages for almost 2,000 years. Let's say what it is that we believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there we will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We spoke about the Holy Catholic Universal Church. You're going to be singing together three verses of I Love Your Church, O Lord. Be seated. Ask that the children will please come forward for children and worship. She got you by a nose there, buddy. All right, ready? And may the Lord, and may the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you, and may he be very, very gracious unto you. And may the Lord lift up his smile on you, and may he give you his peace. Amen. Oh, I know. Yep, you go for it. Going to be going to God in prayer. A couple of announcements. First, we'll be praying for these. It turns out Lee Blankesport did not have to stay in the hospital. Told him that he was doing well enough to the point where he doesn't need to be staying there for these treatments, so he's going to be having bone marrow scans, and that's the next step. Going to be praying for Geraldine Vandevecht. She's at Sanford. As the last number of months have gone on, she's grown increasingly agitated, and that can often happen. I mean, as somebody's health deteriorates in different ways, and yeah, in some ways she's not herself anymore. And you think about a grand old lady of the church. Paul talks to Timothy and Titus about that, saying, be sure to honor these ladies out of all that they've sacrificed for God's people over the years. So we're certainly going to be praying for Geraldine. Other prayer requests, praises. Thankful for the beautiful weather, indeed. Going to pray as well for class this meets again, and one of the churches and pastors will be having a separation. That's always very, very hard. We'll be praying for that, and it seems at least one or two others is going to head into chaplaincy or something of that sort. It's just been a very anxious, difficult time. One of the reasons choosing of love, I love your church, O Lord, was something Chesterton said for pastor appreciation. Some of your gifts, I got myself a portrait of G.K. Chesterton. So if you really ever wonder what I do if I get money, that's what I do, is I wind up buying a portrait of somebody. You might know Chesterton. He wrote a number of all the Father Brown mysteries, but he was a rather famous Christian apologist. And thinking about the church, he was actually thinking about Rome, but he said that the reason that Rome became great was not that it was great and people loved her. Rather, people loved her, and so she became great. And that's how it works. That's Beauty and the Beast. How does something become lovely? You love it. That's how it goes. You don't wait for it to become lovely and then love it. You love it. And then it becomes lovely. And thinking about that with the church, that's what that song's about, is I love your church, and that's what makes it lovely. That's when you put all your efforts and energy, because that's what you do for what you love. But let's go together to our God in prayer. We'll pray for these churches and these difficulties. And Father, it's strange to even sing, we love your church, O Lord, because we're saying that we love ourselves, and that we love those around us. And Father, love what it is that you're creating or have created, and Father, are working to preserve and strengthen in any number of different ways a group of people among whom your word dwells richly, who live not by bread alone, but every promise and every word that you make, who want to become more like Jesus. And Father, it's ultimately the hope for the world, in the sense of people coming to you. And Father, we ask that you'd work through all the various churches of our classes. We lift up the classes meeting we'll have, and we pray for all the various heartaches that are involved with that, as well as, Father, more easy transitions perhaps into other areas and fields of ministry. And we lift up our culture at large, thinking about the church. And Father, some churches have not been meeting in person. Think about a lot of our neighbors to the north, and some of us have family and loved ones there and friends who are involved in churches. And you can think about different friends around the world, Father, who find themselves in situations like Hong Kong and other areas where the church just looks totally different as a result of the past couple years and civic unrest. Father, we know that we're not the first generation to have things like this by any stretch. One of the good things about being your people this far into the life of the church is we've got a lot of history to look back on, and we see that through many dangers, toils, and snares, you've carried your people. It's grace that's led us safe this far. It's grace that's going to lead us home. But we do pray for our classes meeting next week. And Father, we're thankful for your various kindnesses to us. We see it abundantly in the weather today and yesterday. Father, how good it was to see so many people out and about and taking care of various fall projects and getting ready for what's ahead. And Father, for out in the fields, the blessings that were there and are there. We think about the wonderful yields, and especially on top of not being sure what it would look like at all when we think back a couple months ago. Father, we know that we're being cared for. We ask that for each of us, we'd be able to trust that. That each day we are being cared for, that we're being shepherded, and that you know what we need, and that you're working our life out on your terms. Help each of us with that, because trust is so hard for all of us. And Father, we lift up Geraldine in that regard. We think about the blessing that she's been to so many in this church over the years. We think about what you've done through her in various ministries and different lives you've blessed. Father, we ask that the bread that she's cast upon the waters would return to her in the sense of people caring for her and people loving on her. Pray for her children, grandchildren, or her great-grandchildren. Because, Father, that can be difficult to see. And Father, we ask that they be able to restore her to increased strength. And we lift up Lee Blankenspor. We're thankful that he doesn't have to stay in the hospital again. We think about what you've carried him through with a lengthy stay in the hospital, and then these shorter ones. We ask that this bone marrow scan, you know, we've been waiting for this for a while. We ask that they be able to have clear next steps, and whether it's family or other donors who'd be able to be a good match to help him. And we have many other concerns and joys on our hearts. We think about with Diane Niemeyer's surgery tomorrow, we ask that that would go well. Think about those of us who are still in grief, the loss of loved ones recently. And Father, I'm sure if each of us opened up our hearts with all that's going on, it would be quite a bit. So we ask that we would be mindful of that, that people in the pew in front of us and behind us have probably a whole lot more going on than we tend to think. And Father, that we would be very, very patient with one another in that regard. And we ask that you'd be with us throughout the rest of this week. Give us clear wisdom and direction of what to do. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. In preparation for hearing God's word, I'm going to be standing to sing, "Seek Ye First the Kingdom." Please be seated. Realized I got those scripture sheets I put together throughout the whole week and put that time into it, and now they sit in my office by the G.K. Chesterton portrait, so it all comes first full circle. So you're just going to have to think about the different questions this evening, all right? But open up your Bibles to Proverbs. Proverbs 3:27-29. First, we'll read about neighbors, then we'll read about friends. And you're just going to have to trust me that the various Proverbs I list are in the Bible. Proverbs 3:27-29. Do not withhold good from those who deserve it when it's in your power to act. Do not say to your neighbor, come back later, I'll give it tomorrow, when you have it with you. Do not plot harm against your neighbor who lives trustfully near you. Let's go over to Proverbs 17:17. A friend loves at all times, and a brother is born for adversity. I will have the scripture sheets out next week in the evening. I know some people find great help in having those all together. Thinking about neighbors this evening, just want to make it clear, considering I live in the community, I'm not having a go at any particular neighbors, all right? So I don't want anybody thinking like, oh, which of his neighbors is he talking about with this example? I'm not talking about any of my particular neighbors, so I don't want anyone to think that, all right? Because our property is so weirdly shaped, we got any number of different neighbors. Let's go to our God in prayer. Father, we ask that you would give me what I stand in need of to open this book of Proverbs to your people. It's a different book that we often don't study in a comprehensive way, but Father, the wisdom for living is abundant in it. A lot of it seems pretty obvious. But Father, for each of us, it's the very obvious things that we tend to get tripped up on. And so, Father, we ask that you would show us how it is that we're to live with our neighbors, how it is that we're to be friends. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood, beautiful day for a neighbor. Could you be mine? Would you be mine? It's a neighborly day in the beauty wood, neighborly day for a beauty wood. Could you be mine? Would you be mine? I've always wanted to have a neighbor just like you. I've always wanted to live in neighborhood with you. So let's make the most of this beautiful day. And since we're together, we might as well say, would you be my, could you be my, would you be, or rather, won't you be my neighbor? That's the theme song for Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. And we're going to keep returning to Mr. Rogers because what Fred Rogers was trying to do with that, do you ever have that, like as an adult, you can't stop calling somebody Mr. or Mrs., where it's like they continue to call him Mr. or Mrs. even though you're like 40 or 50? Hard to call him Fred Rogers. But what he was trying to do with that show is pretty much very similar to what Solomon's trying to do with Proverbs. This is just wisdom for living. That's all those various episodes. What is it like when you don't get along with a friend? What is it like when you have to do something new and scary? That's all those episodes. Just walking kids through saying, you're going to be okay. Well, let's talk about this. Let's talk about life. You can manage it. That's Proverbs. And both teach life lessons that you never outgrow. Right? There's those wonderful posters, everything I needed to learn, I learned in kindergarten. You don't outgrow those things. You just deepen in them, and the same's true with Proverbs. You don't outgrow this wisdom. You just find yourself applying it in new situations. And our focus this evening is essentially what's in Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood's theme song. It's about neighbors and friends. Well, what that theme song is all about is Fred Rogers imagining a world in which every friend was a neighbor and every neighbor was a friend. That's Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. Various neighbors are friends and they work out their difficulties and frustrations as a way of showing kids how do you deal with your frustrations and difficulties. And a way for a parent when you're watching it with your kids saying, man, that guy knows what's going on. This evening we're going to be seeing that the categories of friends and neighbors, that they're not really, as Fred Rogers, and he knows this or knew this, they're not the same. And they don't have to be the same. But it's saying that how do we treat our neighbors? How do we treat our friends? How do you want to be treated as a neighbor? How do you want to be treated as a friend? Essentially, how do you want to be done to? You would hope others would do to you what you wish you would do to them. And those are two categories, are our 2 points. First is neighbors, and second is friends. First is neighbors. The definition of a neighbor, we always have questions on the slide when you come in. Usually when it's definition questions, those are really, really hard because the most basic things are usually the hardest things to understand in life. Like, how would you define love? That's really hard to get your mind around. Or friend. How would you define friend? That's pretty hard. All right, it's easy to define, a three-wood golf club, but how do you define a friend? How do you define a neighbor? What is a neighbor? And that no matter how you slice a neighbor, at its most basic definition, it's somebody whom you live near. If you share a property line, no matter the definition of a neighbor, you're a neighbor. And living near somebody, that carries certain obligations. That's what's going on with Proverbs 27:14. If anyone loudly blesses their neighbor early in the morning, it will be taken as a curse. Or to modernize this, maybe you're somebody who honks the horn when you see somebody you know, because you're a friendly person, and that's how you see your friendliness coming out. Well, if you do that at 4:45 every morning to your neighbor, it's not going to be seen as something friendly. What it's saying is, okay, just because you think it might be friendly, doesn't think your neighbor's always going to perceive it as friendly. Saying, okay, you and your neighbor are two different people, and they got the right to be on their own turf, you got the right to be on your own turf. Just because you think your neighbor should appreciate something doesn't mean they will. Maybe you really love Bob Seger, and you've got a sound system that you can really kind of push out the sound at about 120 decibels, and you think you're just giving a free Bob Seger concert. I mean, people pay money for this, and you're just pushing it out. And your neighbor, they can listen for free. And you're thinking, man, they should love that. Well, they might not love it. That's what Solomon is saying, essentially, is, okay, you share a property line, kind of keep yours to yours and theirs to theirs. Meaning we shouldn't presume on our neighbors. And that's part of Proverbs 25:17. Again, I'm sorry you don't have your sheet. This is seldom set foot in your neighbor's house too much of you and they'll hate you. Now, this isn't about discouraging friends, neighbors. This isn't about discouraging neighbors becoming friends, about saying, okay, you know, make sure you only show up so often. What this about is saying, okay, beware of presuming upon the fact that your relationship with your neighbor is something more than it actually is. Imagine two neighbors, Bob and Hank, and Bob's a builder. I mean, not surprisingly, it just goes with Bob the builder. And he's got every tool you can imagine. Now, if you have every tool you can imagine, you know that's both a wonderful thing, and you also know that often other people want to use your tools because you've got them. And so Bob would be fine with his neighbor Hank borrowing a tool every now and then, but Hank borrows tools to the point that Bob often doesn't have the tools when he needs them the next day for work. And Bob rarely gets the tools back in a timely way. And Bob finds it pretty frustrating that every time Hank comes over, it seems that Hank just wants something from him. That's what's going on with seldom set foot in your neighbor's house. Too much of you, they'll hate you. That's not saying that don't be friendly to your neighbor, don't get to know your neighbor. No, don't go back and forth. It's not saying that. It's saying beware of presuming on your neighbors. And we need to bear with our neighbors, right? Because we've all got quirks, right? People bear with me. A number of you probably bear with me in tremendous ways. But the flip side is also people bear with you. You got people that bear with you. And that's the call in being a neighbor. But the call here is to say, okay, don't presume upon that bearing. Like kids, I was a teenager, I do that with my parents. You kind of know what your parents are like, and it's easy to presume upon them because you kind of know their limits, and you kind of push them that far, and then you kind of back off. That's just presuming upon your dad's patience. So you don't do that with your neighbor. And this is our first set of questions. You can't write them down, but you can think about them, because we don't have our sheets. But how the first question would be, how do neighbors need to bear with each other? Think about your own experience of being a neighbor. And then how can you bear with your neighbor? And how might your neighbor already be bearing with you? Because again, we're pretty good at that second question is, okay, here's how I could bear with people. But the second one is, people bearing with me? Well, no, man, I totally got everything together. I'm just a pleasure to be around. No, you're about as much of a pleasure to be around as anybody else. We've all got our weirdnesses. So think about that for just a little bit. Again, I'll read it and then you can think. How do neighbors need to bear with each other? How can you bear with your neighbor? How might your neighbor already be bearing with you? If you got pets, you got a kind of a freebie on that. I grew up, we had a beagle, and he would kind of make it a point to go to the various houses in the neighborhood, and if somebody had garbage out of their bin, to rip open that garbage bag. So a lot of the walks of shame of going to the neighbor's house, picking up all their garbage. That's a way that neighbors bear with each other. And a way that, as a kid, probably put harm to neighbors. Neighbors should give real help when needed and avoid doing any harm to one another. And that's what's going on with Proverbs 3, 27 to 29. Don't withhold good from those to whom it's due. When it's in your power to act, don't say to your neighbor, come back tomorrow and I'll give it to you. When you already have it with you, don't plot harm against your neighbor who lives trustfully near you. Essentially, that's pretty obvious. It's saying if your neighbor needs help and you can help, help. If there's anything that might harm your neighbor, don't do that. That's something that Mr. Rogers would say. You can imagine him with, what is it, X the Owl and Henrietta, those two little puppets, and one of them does something the other one doesn't like, and they work it out. Well, they try to do good to one another. That's just how the episodes are. That's Mr. Rogers' neighborhood, and Solomon's just saying this is what neighbors are to be about. You don't outgrow lessons that you live as a child. And neighbors need to help one another without injuring their relationship, because it's a long-term relationship. All right, you don't need to figure out how you're going to maintain good relations with the random cashier at that store that you go to maybe twice a year. You don't need to figure out how to have a relationship with that person. You don't need to figure out how to have a relationship with a person with that relative that you only see once a year. I mean, growing up, we would go on New Year's Day for the noon meal. I always choose it wrong, for dinner. And I'd see people that I have not seen for 365 days, and I would not see for 365 more days, right? I don't need to figure out how to say, how am I going to maintain a working relationship with this person? But you do need to figure out to say, okay, I've got to have good relations with this person that I live right near, because that's a long-term relationship, that you frequently see each other. That's what's behind Proverbs 26, 18 to 19. Like a maniac shooting flaming arrows of death is one who deceives his neighbor and said, I was only joking. Now, on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being something that you would really, really enjoy, 10 being something that would utterly terrifying, a maniac shooting arrows of death, that's closer to the 10 side of things. And what Solomon here is saying is that neighbors who don't deal honestly with each other, and then when caught in some sort of lie, say, well, I was just joking, or whatever they would say to cover it up, that's a lot of trouble, because this is a long-term relationship that you've really got to deal with. It's behaving like a maniac shooting arrows of death. So it's saying, okay, well, tell the truth to your neighbor. And if you didn't tell the truth, make it right, because you're going to be living by each other. You're not going to get away from each other. You got to keep dealing with each other. This is a long-term relationship. So it's say what you mean and mean what you say, and that's different if you've got farmland that bumps up against farmland. That looks different if you've got a zoning issue and somebody's looking at building, I don't know, say a large shed. That's different if you've got, like I imagine when I was a kid with the dog rifling through trash, and then we would have neighbor dogs come over, and then they would attack our dogs. We take our dog to the vet. Like, you figure out how you bear with one another as neighbors there. But it's saying difficulties are inevitably going to arise in a fallen world with fallen people. So when you're dealing with each other, you say what you mean, and you mean what you say. And to do otherwise creates trouble. It's Proverbs 29:5, those who flatter their neighbors are spreading nets for their feet. This isn't saying that complimenting somebody is bad. What it's saying is complimenting somebody in hopes of getting something out of them is going to backfire. All right, buttering somebody up for some reason is going to backfire in the sense of, okay, well, what are they after? It's a whole lot better. I'm sure you wish that people with you would say what they mean what they say. That would be the best compliment you could have. So So that's talking to your neighbor, and this next proverb has to do with talking about your neighbor. It's Proverbs 11:12, whoever derides their neighbor has no sense, but the one who understanding holds their tongue. This, the idea here is, since you're living with your neighbor all the time, be aware that if there's anything that ill that you would say about your neighbor, it could get back to them. Let's go back to Bob and Hank. Now, Bob is quite frustrated that Hank keeps taking his tools and not returning them. And that's an understandable frustration on Bob's part, right? If you've been there, you know that that's frustrating. And you also think, okay, what am I going to do about it? Well, I could talk to Hank, that would be the thing to do. Or I could say, you know what, I'm going to overlook this because I'm not going to talk to him. But Bob, he's not doing that, so Bob's at Ralph's house and he's helping Ralph out with something else. And he tells Ralph, well, man, Hank just keeps mooching off me. And then a couple days later, Bob's in the hardware store. And he's buying new tools because Hank took his other tools, and he's telling the guy the clerk, man, I gotta buy this because my neighbor Hank keeps mooching stuff off me. And the clerk doesn't really say much, and neither do the three people behind Bob in line say much. About a week later, Bob drives home and sees all his tools there in the garage, all the tools Hank ever borrowed, and there's a note saying, here's your tools back from the mooch. Bob just found himself now in a new situation with Hank of how am I going to make things work with my neighbor? That's what's going on with not deriding your neighbor. The idea is, okay, how are you going to work things out considering you've got to stay together and be together? And each of us has situations like this where we look back and we're like, okay, how could I have dealt with this in a way that could make this relationship better? And now this isn't simply about wisdom. Wisdom and righteousness go together. All right, the summary of the horizontal commandments, which is us with each other, is you do to your neighbor as you hope your neighbor would do unto you. And these are just saying, how do you do this in sticky areas of life? That's what Proverbs are about. How do you carry out the law in really sticky areas, which is where a lot of us live all the time? And Jesus reminds us that this definition of the neighbor, it's larger than we think. It's not just the people that we have to deal with all the time. And what's really slick about this is what Jesus is saying is, don't just kind of do good to others because you're going to have to put up with them for the rest of your life. Do good to others because you want to do good to others. So don't just kind of do what's right when it might not come back to bite you. But just do what's right because it's right. That's the parable of the Good Samaritan. Who was the neighbor to this guy? Well, the one who helped him. So this is neighbors. And now let's think about friends. And second is friends. Friends are the best, all right? Everybody likes having friends, but friendship is in serious jeopardy in our culture, serious jeopardy. Studies show, statistics show that men have less friends than they had 30 years ago. So according to one study, 15% of American men say they have nobody they can talk to other than family members. So people that are stuck with them, those are the only people they can actually talk about their life with. The only people in a real way they can talk about life with. Another 18% say they have only one or two close friends. Another 16% say they have only three close friends. So this means a majority of American men have only, at most, three people outside of their immediate family that they can talk to about life in a real way with. Of people who say that they just like me, and so they're by me. We do things together. They know my inmost thoughts. I'm not a burden to them. They for whatever reason think I'm pretty neat, and I think they're pretty neat. Now that's trouble. We're already reaping the trouble of that in our culture. And Augustine's right. He said in this world, two things are essential, a healthy life and friendship. God created humans so they might exist and live. This is life. But if they're not to remain solitary, there must be friendship. What Augustine is saying is life is hard, it's difficult, it's way more complex than we'll ever understand. And if you're going to make it through in any semblance of a way that you don't feel like you're ripped to shreds all the time, you need people who are with you and for you. Those are your friends. Friends are, in the words of Ed Cunningham, those rare people who ask how we are and then wait to hear an answer. So how are you? And then they actually have a sense of wanting to know how you are and want to do something to help if things are wrong or just to be there. In the words of Aristotle, it's a friend is a single soul in two bodies. That's theologically off, but experientially that's the way it is, right? When you have a friend, there's a sense that you two are us, that we're together in this. Becoming friends, that's wonderful. C.S. Lewis wrote about this. He says that the moment when somebody becomes a friend, this is how it goes. One person says to another, wait, you too? I thought I was the only one. Right? That's what friendship is like. Like, you see it that way too? Man. One of C.S. Lewis's best friends, J.R.R. Tolkien, wrote a book series on friendship that's gone on in the last couple decades to make over $1 billion. That's The Lord of the Rings. It's just a friendship story. Very unlikely people becoming friends. That's why people watch it over and over again. Say, man, I wish somebody stuck with me like that. We were built for friendship. You watch kids on the playground. They want to be friends. When they're acting out, it's because they either don't have friends or they're not going about making friends in the best way, but they still want friends. And you see 70-year-olds having coffee. Why are they doing that? Because they want friends. They want somebody who wants to be by them and who takes an interest in them, who's for them. It brings us to our second set of questions, and we don't have our sheet, but think about it. Who are your closest friends? Now, what makes these people such close friends? Who are your closest friends? What makes these people such close friends? Just share the four words I had for what makes them friends. You can see if these are the same for you or similar. I find that the people I put on my list, they listen, they're available, and they care. There's tangible signs that they care. It's a reciprocal relationship. It's not just me checking in, it's them checking in. And there's a level of wisdom where they know how to handle me. And I mean that in the best possible way, if that makes sense. Like, they kind of know how I'm kind of wired. I know how they're wired. But friends are for us. We got Proverbs 17:17. A friend loves at all times, and a brother's born for adversity. The idea here is friends. They're the ones who are with you when you cry. Be the ones who resist the urge to say, don't cry. Because it's like, okay, well, you got your emotions, I totally accept you that way. And at times they find themselves even getting misty-eyed with you, because what hurts your friend hurts you. friends are willing to wade through the mess that we make for ourselves, and they're ready to help us put things back together when we're ready to put things back together. Friends, they know our faults, but they don't dismiss us for our faults. Rather, they make allowances for our faults. They know our strengths, and they tell us we have strengths, because we all need to hear that. Now, you shouldn't expect this from most people. Some people find themselves very frustrated in life because they think everybody is, and nobody is for them, but you shouldn't expect everybody to be your friend. All right, Mr. Rogers' world was ideal. All right? You're not gonna have 8 billion friends that take a real interest in you. You're probably only gonna have a few close people like that. That's just how it works. That's how intimacy works. But we should expect these things from our friends. And well, what I'm saying here is, if you don't have anybody that fits that category of what we've talked about with friendship, ask yourself, where are you in these statistics that we thought about at the beginning of this point? Because we live in a largely friendless culture. It's a very lonely time. Hasn't always been that way. So friends, they're the ones who are knit to your heart. They have your heart. And what that means is, you really got to choose your friends really, really carefully. Proverbs 12:26, the righteous choose their friends carefully, but the way of the wicked leads them astray. The idea here is that the friends, they've got your heart. They speak into your life. And some friends are for each other in ways that aren't good for each other. Meaning that they'll stand with their friend no matter what, even if they'll stand with their friend against God. I mean, that sort of friend, against standing with somebody against God's ways, that person will lead, that will be a friend that will lead you astray. I mean, if you've got a friend who stands with you no matter what, even to the point where they'll stand with you against God, that person's not doing you any favors. So you choose your friends carefully. Now friends, they'll have your best interests at heart, even if it means being against a choice that you're making. Proverbs 27, verse 6, wounds from a friend can be trusted, but an enemy multiplies kisses. Of course, you need to be really careful with these wounds. We think about the book of Job. And those were friends that were willing to wound for the sake of their friend, but at the end, God rebukes them, essentially saying, you don't know what you're talking about. You don't really know what Job's going through. The idea here is, we need to know our friends well enough to know how to wound well, because we know each other so well. Now, that takes a whole lot of time. And friends, they do each other good. Proverbs 29, perfume and incense bring joy to the heart, and the pleasantness of a friend springs from their heartfelt advice. One of the friends on my list I got on here, we would go out for lunch every week, and we lived in Worthington, every week. Accountability partners, we got to know each other as we have lunch. It's like, you know, this is an area I really struggle with. Check in with me on that. And so you get to know each other quite well that way. And again, you choose these very carefully. You don't go around telling everybody all your stuff. But I still keep in touch with him, even though he lives in Thailand now. And I don't keep in touch because we both really like 80s synth rock. Although we do, I keep in touch because exactly what Proverbs is talking about here. Perfume and incense bring joy to the heart, and the pleasantness of a friend springs from their heartfelt advice. He knows me well enough to the point where he knows my hang-ups. He knows various directions that I go that I should not go inside my head. And he calls me back. That's what we all need. We all need somebody to call us back. Because it's not wise to go alone in life. It's Proverbs 18:24. One who has unreliable friends soon comes to ruin, but there's a friend who sticks closer to a brother. There's a whole lot of unreliable. Proverbs is saying, you can find plenty of people. This is what Solomon's saying is, you can find plenty of people to hang out with. Or finding other people to be around, that's not the hard part. Right, you know that there's any number of people who are incredibly lonely in a sea of people. What you want is, you want somebody who's actually going to be for you. Billy Joel, as Billy Joel sang. That video, John DeVries did such a wonderful job. I told him after that video that we should just, I'd be happy to step aside if John would be willing to kind of fill the pulpit, because I mentioned that with the, and Billy Joel, I feel like, man, now I know that they've got a sickness going through their home, so they're not here. But I feel almost awkward quoting Billy Joel now, because he did it better than I did. But I can always find someone to say they sympathize if I wear my heart out on my sleeve. But I don't want some pretty face to tell me pretty lies. All I want is someone to believe. And hopefully you got somebody like that, somebody to believe, somebody there. They're going to tell you in a way that's for you what you need to hear. I mean, I got texts on my phone from years ago. And I, Bethany will tell you, I keep my phone pretty well deleted. I usually have like maybe 7 people on there, because I kind of, if you ever seen that picture of girls' laptop, like girls' desktops and boys' desktops, where it's like 8,000 different icons on the girls' desktops and like 3 on the guys. Like I got mine down to like 2. But I hang on to those ones that somebody's saying something for me. And that's what this proverb is talking about. There's a friend who sticks closer than a brother. Solomon's either talking about making sure you find your friends in the right places, of urging people to say that they're out there, and probably urging them to say, man, check out the covenant community is probably what he's saying, if that's the direction. But it also might be God. Right? Commentators are divided, and maybe it's a both and. Like it's left vague of saying, okay, you need good friends, but you also need God as a friend. That could be. So imagine that. Imagine, this is where we close, imagine a life in which you're God's friend, that he's committed to your good. Imagine a life in which God puts something within you that he looks at and he says, wait, you too? Man, I thought I was the only one. That's regeneration, giving you these desires and saying, man, you love good and truth and beauty, and you love all things that are right. You love everything made new. You love dying to yourself and living for others. You love that too? That's what he puts in you. Becoming your friend. That's why he does it, to become your friend. That's what we thought about this morning. That's what Carl Henry mentioned at the beginning of the service. Into the darkness of my young life, Henry, he writes, God put bright stars that still shine and sparkle. After that encounter, I walked the world with God as my friend. This is in some ways similar to what Jesus says to his disciples in the night when he's going to die. He says, I don't call you servants anymore, even though you're still my servants. He says, now I called you my friends. Why? Because everything that my Father told me, now I've told you. I've told you everything that's on my heart. So you're my friends. I mean, imagine that sort of life. That's the hymn we're going to sing after this. I switched things around because we got the same hymn morning and evening, because both these services are about God being our friend. And I actually chose the morning song with the evening sermon in mind, so that tells you where my brain's at. But this is about God becoming your friend and being your friend. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty. Praise to the Lord who will prosper your work and defend you. Surely his goodness and mercy will daily attend her. Ponder anew what the Almighty can do if with his love he befriend you. What the writer is saying there is thinking about his own life, of saying, man, God became my friend. That's what I need the most. And saying, if God's your friend, remember that. Whatever circumstance you find yourself in, God is your friend. You can't ask for a better friend than that. So praise the Lord for whatever true friends you've got, because they are precious gifts. Doesn't hurt to tell them they're precious gifts. All right, nobody has ever got upset by being told, you are a gift to me. No, nobody's ever got offended by that. And praise the Lord the Almighty that he befriends you. Let's go to him in prayer. Father, think about the Beatles song, oh, look at all the lonely people. And Father, we find ourselves in that age. Very, very lonely age. But Father, we ask that we as your people would know each other, be known by each other. We would risk relationships, risk opening ourselves up, letting others in. Because, Father, that's what you're about. Made in your image, not good for man to be alone, is not merely about marriage by any stretch. It's about relationships. Father, we ask that we would walk forward this week knowing that we're befriended by you, trusting that we are. And Father, we ask that we be doing unto our neighbors as we would have them do unto you, rather do unto us. In Jesus' name, amen. So, again, at this point we're calling an audible here. So, Jesu, Jesu, fill us with your love. We're going to set that to the side. I remember growing up thinking I was so multicultural when I was 14 years old because we were singing Jesu rather than Jesus. I thought it was kind of like me and the UN together. But we're going to put this to the side, and we're going to sing praise to the Lord, the Almighty. And think about that verse when we get to, if with his love he befriend you. Go to our God together in prayer for our offering. Father, we think about the early church sharing their various resources in common. We think about ways we can be of help and help. We think about the meat pantry, the freezer pantry, and Father, that being restocked. And Father, we as well think about the banquet. We think about the offering of food that we're giving, Father. We ask that in this way we'd be doing unto our neighbors as we would hope they would do unto us. And Father, we ask that you'd be working through our offerings for others' good and for your glory, and to change us to be more like your Son, who gave it all for our sake. In Jesus' name, amen. And go from this blessing from your friend. And may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you. May he be very, very gracious unto you. May the Lord smile on you. May he give you peace. Amen.